Hey guys, welcome to the Best Practices Show, where we take a look at the best business practices from the best dental practices all across the country. And I've got a super cool topic, one of the most controversial topics in all of dentistry, and it's the opportunity. It is the great awakening in restorative dentistry. You've already seen it. It's coming your way. And I've got one of the world's best experts, probably nobody better than him, Dr. DeWitt Wilkerson from the Dawson Academy. And this is some powerful stuff. So do me a favor, hit the share button and grab a pen. We'll see you in a second. Hey guys, welcome back to the Best Practices Show. My name is Kirk Barrett, and I'm so grateful you're watching because we are having so much fun talking about the thing that we care about the most, which is this great profession of dentistry. And today is a really special episode. I got one of my dear good friends on. We're going to be talking about one of the greatest opportunities and very controversial issues in all of dentistry. And, you call it the great awakening. And so, Dr. DeWitt Wilkerson, DeWitt, thank you so much for being on. I really appreciate this, my friend.
Well, Kirk, thank you for letting me be part of this. And first of all, I want to thank you for a great weekend. Last weekend, we were together in Clearwater, Florida at the Dawson Alumni Retreat, and you were the keynote speaker on Saturday, and you blew our socks off. In fact, I want to tell you, you ruined my Sunday because I spent the whole Sunday rearranging my life as a result of what you taught us. Have 3 pages of notes. My staff is going to have to change everything. It's just great. And so I want to thank you for that. It was an amazing time and you're the best.
Well, I really appreciate it. It was such an honor for me to be there. And being that meeting was kind of like full circle. And so if you're watching this and you don't know what the Dawson Academy is, I'll let you know kind of what it is, because it's really one of the places, if not the place, I started my journey in dentistry, started by Dr. Peter Dawson, who is truly one of the most influential icons in all of dentistry. And Pete's not only a great clinician, incredible teacher, but a super human being. And so at the age of 24, and I'll just tell my journey a little bit, because it's really cool how this has all come together. At the age of 24, I had a dentist, and a friend of mine say, you got to go take this course. And I remember, I'm like, I'm not going to go see this course from a 64-year-old dentist. And I was thinking, what's a 64-year-old dentist going to teach me for 3 days? And I flew out there and it changed my whole life. And I keep saying this over and over and again. If you guys have been watching the show, at the age of 20, you don't really know anything. And you think you got it all figured out, though. But then you turn 30 and you go, there's a lot I don't know. And then 40, you wonder if you know anything. And Pete started that journey for me and I got so excited. And so I feel so crazy honored to, number one, call you my friend, number two, just to be a part of that incredible community, which we're going to talk a lot about today, and some very interesting things coming up. Now, tell people who DeWitt Wilkerson is, if they don't know who you are. Affectionately, we all call you Wit, right?
Right, that's right. Well, as you were talking about your story, I have to tell you quickly mine. I knew Pete Dawson growing up as a friend. I didn't know he was a dentist. And I ran into him right before I started dental school at 22, and he asked me what I was doing. I said, I'm going to dental school, and he went, fantastic. And I said, are you a dentist? And he said, yes. And so he invited me to come spend the day in his office. And at the end of the day, he gave me this textbook. Actually, it was his textbook. And I had no idea he was a teacher, writer, or any of these things. And he said, I want you to read this before you start dental school. And I have 3 courses I teach out at St. Petersburg Beach. And we've got time for you to get those in before you start dental school. So I went with him to seminar 1, 2, and 3 at the Dawson, what was then just the Dawson seminars, and listened to him talk about advanced restorative techniques and problem solving and TMJ when no one knew what that was. I'm talking 1978. And so I read his book and went to his 3 seminars before dental school. Wow. And during dental school, sat through most of my classes under my breath saying, Pete wouldn't agree with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so I knew a little bit more than I probably needed to know at the time. But that was my start, and I was very blessed to have him invite me to join the practice in 1982 when I finished school, and, you know, to work beside him and our other partners since then. So, you know, we've seen it all, and the evolution of what now are the classic principles of occlusion, but also understanding of what TMJ disorders are, what's going on inside the joint when there's problems, and all the manifestations of that. What I want to talk about today with you, which we're calling the Great Awakening, is really taking all of those concepts which we've learned and Pete helped us to master, and even expand on that, because there's so many breakthroughs happening in medicine right now. And so when we talk about the Great Awakening and restorative dentistry, Kirk, what I'm thinking about is we all hear there's courses all over the country right now on sleep apnea, mm-hmm. and treating sleep apnea. And the real subject matter typically is, hey guys, here's an opportunity. See if you can't get these patients off CPAPs onto oral appliances, and we're going to figure out a way to get medical reimbursement for it. And we got to get the physicians, you know, connecting with us, so they're sending us patients, because we're onto something that can really be great. And that's sort of the topic of sleep apnea. What I'm learning is the fact is sleep apnea is a small part of a much bigger subject, and the bigger subject has to do with something very fundamental. It's called oxygen.
Yeah.
And so breathing and airway are huge. I just went to a symposium 2 weeks ago in Chicago, and it was all about breathing, airway, sleep apnea, craniofacial development. They had 65 speakers there over 3 days from all over the world. I'm talking Stanford Medical School, Harvard Medical School, Yale Medical School, Australia, Italy, Spain, on and on it goes. All these fabulous researchers who were primarily ENTs and pediatricians and researchers, PhDs, gastroenterologists, talking about airway and how critical it is to health. And that if your airway isn't properly operating, you're going to be an unhealthy person.
Right.
Now, where this really gets interesting is it directly relates to craniofacial growth and development, and to occlusion, mm-hmm. and to TMJ disorders, and to sleep apnea. So all these things that we're interested in, that we've been working really hard to study for all these years and understand, and how do we solve these problems, there were always some basic links missing that we didn't quite understand, especially cause and effect.
Right.
And so many things that we would describe as neurologic, or, you know, central nervous system mediated and things like that, we just really didn't know what was going on. We're really getting a better understanding of it. One of the unbelievable things that I heard that I'm still thinking about it was Dr. Christian Gimeno, who is the lead researcher at Stanford University for the last 35 years, he's the one who developed terminology like apnea hypopnea index and upper airway resistance syndrome, and some of the things that those in that arena and some of us that have delved into that under, you know, recognize those terms. He was telling us about in utero, the third trimester, how these developing children are training on how to swallow properly. And they're swallowing as much as 500 milliliters of amniotic fluid every day in preparation for coming out into the world, so that they can separate what goes into their lungs from what goes down into their stomach. And that children that are born prematurely often are underdeveloped in their training and have problems. And he was showing slides of children in their pediatric intensive care unit at Stanford, where their abdomens would be real distended because they were swallowing air and their stomachs were full of air, things like that. So he's saying the airway is important even before birth.
Yeah.
And then at birth, of course, it's huge. And so,
yeah. Well, let me ask you though, because this is a huge issue, and I've got so many things, like, because this is a very hot topic.
Yes.
And when you talk about airway, and you and I were talking about this before we got started, you know, typically, and I have apnea, And I found at the age of 40, and I remember going for the test because my cardiologist said, look, be proactive. And I'm like, I'm not going, that's for, you know, people that are overweight, because typically as a general public, or as maybe even the dental profession, you know, people that have apnea usually fit one group, but there's actually three demographic groups, right?
There's three. There's, if you want to break it out into a nice discussion, put it in boxes of discussion, I would break it out into three categories, and that is young children from birth till about 9 years old is a key time in development of the airway, breathing problems, even things like sleep apnea, upper airway resistance where you can't breathe through your nose, snoring, clenching, grinding, bruxism, all these things manifest themselves in these young children. A second interesting category is someone who's delved daily into the area of TMJ or TM disorders, and that is what we're calling young fit females. In other words, that population that is not overweight, is not older. I'm talking about 20s, for example, and Dr. G. Minot, in one of his research projects, took 30 young adults, primarily females, who were then went through a sleep study and diagnosed with upper airway resistance syndrome. They couldn't breathe through their nose easily. And then he began to describe their symptoms. Their symptoms were things like 17 out of 30 said they woke up almost every morning with a headache.
Wow.
Majority of them were having fatigue daily, where they felt symptoms that we might compare to fibromyalgia or chronic fatigue syndrome. They had a number of signs and symptoms that I, with my history, would call very classic TMJ symptoms.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Now, right. What I'm saying isn't that what we have understood isn't correct, and that occlusion isn't important, and that you can stimulate bruxism through malocclusion and a variety of things like this. What I'm saying is that there's a group over on one side looking at this subject of these patients with signs and symptoms and calling it this, and there's another group at another end of the spectrum of medicine that are studying the same population and giving it a different name and identifying different factors. Right. The truth is, it overlaps. And so if I'm going to be seeing dental patients that are coming in and saying, I wake up in the morning, I don't feel good, I think I've been clenching and grinding, I have periodic headaches in the morning, my jaw's tired, my joints hurt, all these things, then one of the things that I should be asking myself as a clinician, as an oral physician, is could they have an airway problem? That should be one of the primary questions that I'm asking, along with, is the disc intact in their temporomandibular joint? Do I need an MRI to look at, you know, these are the things that we've done. But now we're also asking, could there be an airway problem? Right. And, you know, it's very interesting because I have a lot of referrals in my practice of TMJ type patients. And now on a regular basis, my assistants will come in and speak with me before I go in to meet the patient. And they'll look at me and say, this one's got an airway problem. Right. And it's just like that. They can ask a few questions, and it's very obvious and very common, very, very common. And so the overlap is huge. And if we're not addressing that, we're missing a very important factor. That's why I'm calling it the Great Awakening, is because of the fact it's like a big aha, but it also has to do with those patients that, you know, we've called the sleep apneic patients. The third category, you're asking about three. First category being the little children, newborn right on up through, say, 9 years old. The second category being young, fit females. The third category is the obvious one. And we're going to call that category the fat old men.
Right.
And so the guys that you look at and you say, well, that guy's definitely got sleep apnea. He's got no neck, you know. I mean, breathing through his mouth. I mean, you can look at him and tell he's not well and he looks tired. He's got bags under his eyes and, you know, he snores like a freight train, and he's the obvious one. Kirk, I have to mention something to you, because certainly you don't fit the profile of someone who would be thought of as the stereotypic sleep apneic patient. I have sleep apnea too.
Wow.
And I'm 6'3". I weigh 190. What I found was that I was snoring and getting a sore throat. Well, we did a sleep study, and my AHI was 29. 30 is considered severe, mm-hmm. and I was 29. I just happened to be, now you want to get controversial, let's get controversial.
Yeah.
I just happened to be a whole generation of, I think, induced sleep apneics, and that is I had four bicuspids extracted, and everything was pulled back, meaning my airway was actually restricted by my dental arch in the room that my tongue had to live in. The box of my tongue space has been limited by that. We see a lot of patients who've had four bicuspid extractions and retraction of the maxillum, retraction of the mandible, who actually have airway problems but don't show the stereotypic, you know, body type, if you will, for that. So that's controversial.
Yeah.
But now, one of the things that's being discussed in ortho among those that would consider themselves actually airway orthodontists, and the discussion among those really sharp guys and gals that are doing that is that they very rarely, almost never remove teeth, yeah. and are focused on expanding the arches, enlarging the arches, not only widening them laterally, transversely, but also anteriorly to give more room for the airway, for the tongue, for breathing,
right,
and to improve that.
Now, can I ask you a question on that too? Because you and I were talking before we got started. This is a trend. So you use the word epigenetic, and anthropologists have done studies just because this isn't like a, describe epigenetic, and University of Michigan did a study.
Okay.
And tell us about that study and how it's affecting how teeth erupt even nowadays. Okay. So walk us through that.
So let's go back a while a ways. There's a anthropologist named Coricini, and he is, I believe, in Michigan, and he actually is a full-time anthropologist, but his interest is dental malocclusion.
Mm-hmm.
That's been his life work.
Wow.
And he's written a book called I don't know the exact title, but it's for orthodontists about dental malocclusions. And he studied skulls in museums all over the world thousands of years back. And his conclusion is that malocclusions, dental malocclusions, are a more recent phenomena in the last couple hundred years. And he believes it's very likely related to our change in diet and eating processed foods. And he describes how in the hunter-gatherer groups that you would find that the children, once they're weaned, they're eating whatever's on the table.
Right.
So you've got one-year-olds that are eating beef jerky. And I mean, they're having to gnaw away at it and use their tongue and their facial muscles very aggressively trying to break this down and digest it. And that actually is what helps develop proper dental arch form, mm-hmm. because you're using your tongue, you're filling the palate, you're enlarging the width and diameter of the dental arch on the maxilla, and that at the same time is actually increasing the size of the nasal airway, mm-hmm. because the maxilla is the floor of the nasal airway. And so when the nasal passages are narrowed, you don't use your nose, you're breathing through your mouth, you're actually going to have more narrowed nasal passages too and more difficulty breathing through your nose. But when you properly function using your tongue and your muscles of mastication, even before your teeth erupt, you're going to come in with a nice rounded out arch form, and same with the mandible. When the tongue is laying on the floor of the mouth and you're eating broken up soft food, you're not having to use your tongue, and if you're breathing through your mouth, which could go along with the development of more allergies in recent times, mm-hmm. too, then it's going to create a more narrow arch form. The study at University of Michigan that was done, and I believe in the 90s, they took newborn monkeys and they actually put silicone plugs in their noses and sewed their noses closed. So they were forced to breathe their life throughout their lifetime and through their development through their mouth. Every one of those monkeys developed an elongated face and a narrow dental arch. So epigenetics is the environmental influence on genetics, how we can change rapidly through changes like in diet and chewing, through breathing through the mouth rather than through the nose. And you can see first generation changes. Mm-hmm. And that was what they saw. Just really, really fascinating study. And so that's what we're looking at now. Let me give you an easy example to understand, and that is this. So you take a child, and the child now is weaned if they breastfed, and now mom gives the child cow's milk. Mm-hmm. And this child happens to be allergic to dairy. And so the child begins to develop congestion and a runny nose, and they can't breathe through their nose, so they start breathing through their mouth. Now they're breathing through their mouth. Now I want you to think about this, Kirk, okay, because I want you to compare it to the air conditioning filters in your home.
Okay.
So you've probably done this before, where you forgot to change your filter out for a couple months.
All the time.
And you pull the filter down, and it's so sooty, you just can't believe it. And you're thinking, air can't even go through that filter. But also, this is what's in the air in our house. Wow. A lot of junk in the air, right? A lot of dirt in the air. So the filter is very important. If you just left the filter out in your air conditioning system, your air conditioning system would get dirty and sick, and you develop mold, and eventually you couldn't even probably live in that house because it would become a sick building. You with
me?
All right. So now let's compare that to the nose. So I believe, as I know you do, that everything about our body is designed with a purpose. And when you breathe through your nose, you're filtering the air. Also, it's a fact that you release nitric oxide in your nasal passages. Nitric oxide is a wonderful molecule that's produced by the body that not only dilates your blood vessels and can reverse cardiovascular disease, aka kale, because it's rich in nitrogen, as are all the cruciferous vegetables that are very good for trying to reverse cardiovascular disease. But in your nose, not only does it dilate the vessels and the air passages in your nose, but nitric oxide also is a it can kill bacteria and other pathogens that can come into your body. So it actually is a first line of defense to stop pathogens that may enter into your airway and into your lungs and your bloodstream. So breathing through your nose is super important for filtering, just like the air filter in your home. So now this little child has come back to him or her. So this child's got dairy allergy, and this nose is stuffy, and the nose is running, and there's congestion. So the child's got their mouth open, they're breathing through their mouth. They're breathing all that dirty air through their mouth, bypassing the filter right into the back of the throat, which is where the tonsils are. Mm-hmm. So that lymphoid tissue, which is there as a defense against infections, is going to be constantly insulted. So now the lymphoid tissue, the tonsils, could begin to enlarge or inflame. Now that poor child not only can't breathe through their nose because of the allergies from dairy, they can't breathe through their mouth very well either. And that child may begin snoring. That child may begin bruxing. That child may develop sleep apnea. That child's oxygen levels may drop in their sleep, just like the fat old man that's got full-blown sleep apnea.
Right.
So now this child is going from, if there's three stages of sleep, two light stages and one deep stage. Deep stage is the restorative phase. Deep stage is where you release growth hormones if you're a child, and you begin to grow up. If you're in a state where when you go to sleep, you get down from light sleep to deeper light sleep, and then you have this alarm system go off saying, hey, we're choking to death here, and you have an arousal, then you stay in those two stages of sleep, and you never get down to the deep restorative stage, which everything good happens. So now this poor little child gets up in the morning, and they feel terrible.
Right.
And so now let's take it forward a couple of years. They get into kindergarten. They're 5 years old, and they're in kindergarten, can't breathe through their nose, runny nose, allergies all the time, can't breathe through their mouth well, the other tonsils are enlarged, sleeping poorly, wake up feeling lousy, cognitively aren't sharp.
Right.
At school, their behavior isn't good. You know what we call that, don't you?
ADHD.
ADHD. And so what do we do with kids that the teacher comes to mom and dad and says, I think we've got a child that has ADHD. Your child isn't learning his alphabet well. Child isn't behaving well. Child's putting his head down on his desk, uninterested when we're learning.
every person could finish the sentence that you're trying to ask. What do? We write a script as fast as possible.
For an amphetamine.
Wow.
So we put this child on speed to fix it. And the fact is the child's got allergies and can't breathe and isn't getting enough oxygen, isn't getting restorative sleep. And if we address that, now when do you address it? See, this child also has a narrow maxillary arch. They may even have a crossbite. Right. Because of the fact their tongue is laying in the floor of their mouth. It doesn't go up in the roof of their mouth. It doesn't spread out their upper teeth as they come in. So they have a very narrow vault, V-shaped arch, V-shaped palate. What does that mean about their nasal airway? V-shaped, meaning super narrow, so it's even harder to breathe. So when do we start ortho? The average age for starting ortho would be 11 or 12. Wow. But the problem starting at 1.
Right.
And if you caught this child at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and you identified that they're a mouth breather, they've got congestion, they've got allergies, we check all that out, that their airway is blocked, their tonsils are enlarged, they've got upper airway resistance syndrome, you could take that, let's call it a four-year-old, you could take a four-year-old and you could reverse that in a matter of weeks.
Right.
And there's literally functional appliances that can expand that upper arch in weeks with these children. And you can do that and you can train them. There's a therapist now called myofunctional therapists that actually work with children. A lot of hygienists are getting that training. A gal named Joy Moeller, M-O-E-L-L-E-R, has a website. And she's in California. She trains a hygienist. Dentists can do it too. And you can learn about retraining the tongue. How do you swallow properly? What are exercises that you can use to get the tongue up into the roof of the mouth and get the mouth closed and start breathing through the nose? One of the interesting things, Kurt, besides evaluating allergies and dealing with that, which was really the source of this child's problem that we've been describing, but also it's a fact that most of us who say, yeah, my nose is kind of congested most of the time, I can't breathe through my nose well. If you close your mouth and breathe through your nose only for about 5 minutes, usually the congestion will clear up.
Yeah.
And what the researchers are telling us now is very often your nose is congested because you don't use it. And when you use it, it'll actually dilate and open up, and the nitric oxide and all those things will help you breathe through your nose. So you need to force yourself to breathe through your nose. So that brings up another interesting thing that we've been toying with. I'm on a kind of a chat room site with other people that are interested in this subject that are in dentistry primarily. And it started out with about 50 of us about 2 years ago. There's now 400 on this chat site that are all clinicians, researchers at universities all around the world from other countries. And we talk about ideas that we haven't talked about in public yet, you know, that we can discuss together and try in our practice, but we're not ready to lecture on it, you understand?
Right.
And one of those things that's been really very interesting that's been going on behind the scenes is literally taping your mouth shut when you sleep at night.
Right.
You may have heard of that, but we have tried that with a number of patients, and it's amazing. You haven't experienced a good night's sleep until you tape your mouth shut and force yourself to breathe through your nose all night long.
Yeah.
And when I do that, I sleep like an hour longer, literally.
Right. Well, let me piggyback on that. So I saw a mutual friend of ours, Dr. Jeff Rouse.
Yeah.
And I saw him in January. And so whenever I see him, we hang out and we hug each other and we're so good. And he goes, and he's always doing an evaluation on me because I am apneic. And I told him about some of the challenges that I've been having. And he goes, I got something for you. He comes back down and he gives me some tape. I'm like, it started to freak me out. Cause I'm like,
yeah,
I'm going to put, he goes, my son does it. So that night I actually took it and I put it over my mouth. Cause I'm like, what if I don't wake up? Yeah. And I will tell you, like, I saw elephants when I was sleeping. I was like, you know, it was like real vivid dreams. I'm like, I feel so good. So it's been 2.5 months, but every night I take his tape,
put it over
my mouth, and I feel great. So I'm so glad you said that, 'cause I thought I was weird.
Yeah. Well, you might be a little bit weird, but, but we all are.
Right.
Anyway, and to piggyback on that, now another dear friend of ours, Keith Thornton,
yes,
who developed the TAP appliance, the Thornton anterior positioner, and he's the extraordinary inventor, and he's a mentor of Jeff's and mine and others. And Keith now actually has developed a interim appliance called a MyTAP, and right, on it he has a little, he calls it a mouth shield. And the MyTAP has a little stem that comes out between your lips, and then you can adjust the mandible forward. It's an upper and lower appliance that mm-hmm. you can adjust the mandible forward to open the airway. And he actually has made a little rubber-like shield that slides over the stem that goes underneath your lips that is instead of taping.
Wow.
So that it closes inside, you know, it closes your mouth so that you breathe through your nose. And so it's an alternative to taping. Another alternative to taping, if patients just kind of freak out, is you can literally go down to CVS or Walgreens and buy, they have those snore head, I'm going blank on it, snore, it wraps around your head and it lifts your chin up and closes
oh, really?
Your mouth. Yeah, I'm going blank on the name of it, but so it's external. It just goes around. It's a snore strap, I think they call it.
Okay.
And it keeps your mouth closed that way, and it doesn't go across your mouth. But the whole concept, Keith, is when you breathe through your nose, you're producing that nitric oxide,
yeah,
and you're properly ventilating, not hyperventilating, which often right. happens. When you see somebody that's sick, what do they look like? They look like this, right?
Yeah.
Tongue out, mouth open, and shoulders hunched over, and you see somebody like that, you immediately know they're sick. And so the whole idea of this is breathing through your nose will control the rate of breathing, which is very important. It will produce that nitric oxide. It'll humidify. It'll decontaminate, if you will, and purify the air. Now warm it as well as it goes down to your lungs. Now you're breathing the real deal, what you really want. Yeah. But imagine when we think about this filtering and lack of filtering, when you're breathing through your mouth and then do that for years. So
right.
you really have a hard time explaining how somebody can breathe through their mouth and be healthy any
right.
more than somebody can be an uncontrolled diabetic and be healthy
right.
or have yeah. uncontrolled sleep apnea and be healthy. You see
right.
all these things are huge for health, and that's what
yeah.
we're after.
And that's what we're after. Now, you and I talked about this too, because you know, it's easy to talk about kids that have these challenges now, because and all of us, as we watch our children grow, we're like, oh my goodness, like, and you see this happening. But as we age too, you talked about early dementia, you know,
yeah.
Talk
yeah,
about that
absolutely.
With the lack of oxygen and what you're learning now.
There was a great study that's ongoing at the at UCLA in California, and they've been studying this. They're actually doing MRIs of the brain and looking at, they can look in a certain kind of scan at oxygen in the brain. And what they've learned is that uncontrolled sleep apnea, someone who has significant sleep apnea that's untreated, will show signs of oxygen deprivation that will actually create brain damage.
Mm.
And there's certain neurotransmitters, glutamate and GABA, I won't go into all that, but that are regulators. One's kind of like it turns on the excitement center, the stress center in your brain, and the other one's kind of a calming effect, and it helps to get you calmed down and quieted down. And what they found with sleep apnea, you get out of control. It's like the brake pedal, you know, is not active, and there's too much stress in the system all night long because of the lack of oxygen, and that will create literally neurologic damage. Now, here's the good news is, let's say you have a guy in his 50s and he says, man, I'm starting to forget my phone number, and I think I may be getting Alzheimer's, and it's kind of early, but I think I got it, you know,
right.
And they can show all those signs and have that really being expressed. If that is treated, they showed it's completely reversible. And they did a study where they basically used, at this point in this study, a CPAP. And using the CPAP, in less than a year, repeating the MRIs, everything had reversed to totally normal. So basically, you've got a population of foggy, you know, brained men and women out there who think they're developing dementia, which they are, but it's not Alzheimer's.
Right.
And so they actually could get intervention and reverse it and return to normal. But if they were to know that, you know, that snoring that I'm expressing that's running my wife out of the bedroom could actually more than a third of the time be a sign of sleep apnea, which could actually create brain damage, I think people would be more inclined to pursue a diagnosis and, right. And treatment for that.
Yeah. Now, in the Great Awakening, now I only understand a fraction of really what you're talking about, Wick, because this is brilliant. And one of the things when you talk about the Great Awakening in dentistry, I mentioned this story to you, is that my wife and I, Sarah, went to the Cooper Clinic and met with Dr. Kenneth Cooper. And that day I got Dr. Ken Cooper and Tyler Cooper. And I learned from them that day. They said, you know, they asked me what I did. I said, I work in dentistry. They go, you guys are our future. And I'm like, what do you mean? And he said this, do you understand billionaires park their planes over here? They land them right over there. And they come into my office and they go, give me the pill. And I go, you want the pill? And they go, yeah, give me the pill. He goes, I'll give you the pill. It's health is two things. 70% of health is how you move your body and what goes in that hole under your nose. I said to him, I go, you tell people that? He's like, yeah, I tell people. He goes, dentists are the, we're the, you're the guard. You're the heir apparent of how this country is going to get healthy. And so when you're talking about this, like, we're not talking about occlusal disease. We're not talking just about you're talking about guarding the one thing that's going to keep people healthy for a long time. Absolutely. And it's more than just teeth.
Absolutely. Well, Dr. Cooper, I've been to the Cooper Clinic too, and it had physicals there and learned so much. And Dr. Cooper, of course, is the father of aerobics and has written over 30 books on exercise physiology and how it relates to longevity. And one of the things I love that he says is he said, you know, when you look at health and age as a graph, he said, what you find is that throughout a lifetime, health goes down, 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 and then finally you pass away. He said, what our goal is to square off the curve. Right. He said, you can stay healthy your whole lifetime and then go to sleep one night and not wake up the next morning. That's what we want to do. That's and he's 85 years old and he's in great health. And
he is.
So he's a living example of this. But all of these factors of lifestyle come into play. And what Dr. Cooper taught us that I found very encouraging, and you say this as well when you're teaching, and that is that 30 minutes of aerobic exercise a day, 6 days a week, is 90% of the cardiovascular benefit of exercise. So you can go run races and go long distances and kill yourself if you want to working out, but 90% of the effect of exercise is achieved through 30 minutes of cardiovascular exercise. And he says that can be fast walking.
Wow.
I mean, where you can still talk, you know, so it's not the out of breath, but just perspiring and getting your heart rate up. And so that's something that I talk to even about with my older patients, because keep moving, get out there and walk, you know, 30 minutes and as fast as you're able to, but just do it. Mm-hmm. And that's a huge thing. And of course, nutrition is huge too. And dear friend of mine, David Seaman, who's a neurologist and a nutritionist, and he happens to also be a trained chiropractor, he studied the biochemistry of nutrition for over 30 years. You ought to have him on the show sometime. You would
okay.
David Seaman. But David says that in the Western diet, 60% of what we eat is inflammatory in nature, 60%. And that the number one cause of inflammation is what we eat, And now we can add in stress and lack of exercise and poor sleep. All those things add up.
Yeah.
But you can't ignore nutrition because it's huge. And it's, you know, I always think of the example, if you bought a $1 million racehorse, would you feed it junk food?
No.
But what about your kids?
Right.
You know, and so, I mean, that's the irony, you know, of how we live. And would you buy a Maserati and put diesel in it?
No,
of course not. You know, and yet we do that to our own bodies because we just don't think.
Right.
And yet all the answers are there. And it's very simple. Eat whole foods. Right. Eat food the way that it grows, and you're going to be good. And that includes protein, including what we call clean, lean protein. So no antibiotics, no hormones, and you know, a high protein content, lean meat. And go for it. Go for it. It's a misnomer that, you know, fat is the main killer. It's refined carbs and sugars and modifying food, like frying it and, you know, destroying the chemistry of what the good Lord made for us. So go for less ingredients on the label, Kirk.
Yeah.
Like if the label said apple, that's probably okay.
Yeah. And I don't think anyone would disagree with you. I mean, all you have to do is go to the grocery store and take a look around. I mean, it's just, it's one bad thing followed by another thing almost everywhere. And my cousin works for Boston Scientific and does the endo equipment.
Oh, yeah.
And he said, you know, in Europe, we don't sell any of this equipment because there's no, you know, the incidence of colon cancer, just, I mean, people eat real food there, you know, so they're a lot healthier. And there's no question. So, okay, now a lot of this is overwhelming, Whit. It's just like, if you're a dentist and you're a restorative dentist, let's say I'm a 32-year-old dentist watching this, I'm like, oh my goodness, like I'm starting to notice things now. I'm just starting to become aware because I probably have 10 patients that I could fit in one of these three categories. Where would you start? What would you tell a young dentist who's just starting to learn about this stuff?
Well, let's talk about it and keep it simple. Let's say you see children, all right? So in your practice, you're going to ask a few simple questions about the child's breathing. Can the child easily breathe through their nose? Do they have allergies that make it difficult? You know, do they have sinus infections and things that could be related to all these things? So are there allergies they're dealing with that affect their breathing? Does the child mouth breathe? If they mouth breathe, that's a big red flag. You know, as their teeth begin to develop, then you can begin to look at their dental arches. So is this a child with a narrow dental arch, which is absolute proof positive that their tongue doesn't go up in the roof of their mouth and expand their arch as it should if they're swallowing properly. So you can look at their dental arch. Do they have super erupted upper anteriors, or do they have an anterior open bite? Those are different, but they're both signs of change related to airway. Do they have a narrow maxillary arch? Do they have crossbite? You know, things like that would all be signs of that would be manifested. Then look in the back of their throat. And one of the things that's really insightful, I think, Kirk, that's really easy to understand is, you know what the uvula is, the little punching bag in the back of your throat.
Absolutely.
Right? So there was a guy named Malinpati. He was a anesthesiologist, and he would have patients just open their mouth wide, and he'd look back there for that punching bag, the uvula, and he classified it into stages. So if it was sitting up real high and dry, he'd call it stage one. Mm-hmm. If you could see it, but the tongue was kind of touching almost the top of the bottom of it, that would be two. If it's partially obstructed, you can't see it all, that's a three. And if you can't see it at all, that's a four. Mm-hmm. And other studies have shown that those with Malinpati fours, where you can't see the uvula, not by going, because that raises your soft palate, but just open wide and look back there. If you can't see it at all, there's about a 90%+ chance that you have an airway problem, okay? Mm-hmm. And so now, here's the interesting part about this, is that if you can't see it, that means your soft palate is dropped way down in the back of your throat. The reason that is it's attached to your hard palate, which is your maxilla. And if your maxilla is set back, meaning it hasn't fully developed, then your soft palate is going to be down your throat. Mm-hmm. And so it's really a sign of an underdeveloped maxilla,
right?
Underdeveloped upper jaw. And so that would be something. Look in the back of the throat. Is the tissue filling the whole back of the throat? Is there a lot of tonsil tissue? Is the uvula dropped down quite a bit? So does the child have problems breathing? Can the child breathe through their nose? Does the child have allergies? Do they have runny nose and lots of colds and things like this? Do they breathe through their mouth? Is their dental arch changing? Is their dental arch narrow? Here's one other that we're really starting to focus on, is the tongue. And the tongue has to be mobile, right? So if you want the tongue to fill the palate and spread the teeth out, it's got to be able to get there. Well, a lot of children have tongue tie. So the little frenulum, we call it, underneath the tongue,
okay,
that can tie the tongue down so you can't stick your tongue out or you can't lift your tongue up high, is a very common problem. And you're usually going to have airway and breathing problems if you're tongue-tied. So what I do is I have all patients, any age, open your mouth real wide and then take your tongue and try to lift it up and touch the back of your upper front teeth. See how close you can. So you go.
Uh-huh.
And some people do that and they can only get their tongue like halfway up there.
Okay.
Because it's tied down.
Wow.
And so there's a lot of attention now with children, not only newborns that can't latch, you know, to their mother. And that obviously creates problems. And so there's a lot of tongue tie releases on newborns. That's very common. A lot of dentists are doing that now for pediatricians, getting out their laser, you know, and just going zip, zip, and releasing that tongue tie. I know one friend in Dallas, Texas, he does about 40 newborn tongue tie releases a month.
Wow.
in his dental practice. So he has pediatricians from around Dallas that are sending him these babies that have tongue tie, and you don't even have to give them anesthetic. You just get out your laser and go zip, zip, and about 10 seconds, you know, you've relieved it. So I'm oversimplifying that, and those that are involved in doing tongue tie release would probably be listening to me cringing because sometimes there's much more to it than
absolutely
that. But I'm just trying to give you the picture. So tongue tie is another thing with little children. How do they sleep? What's their behavior like? Are they having behavioral issues? You know, are they slowed down cognitively? Do they show signs of what, you know, might be thought of as ADD type symptoms? Then those are all. Are they still bedwetting at 3, 4, 5, 6 years old? Because bedwetting can go along with the sympathetic nervous system, which is the fight or flight response that right happens when you're not breathing well, and you release cortisol, which is a stress hormone, into your bloodstream, which can excite your heart, but it also can screw up a lot of the chemistry of your body if it's chronic. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you're getting chased by something, good, you need the right, you need the stress hormone, but you don't want it continuing chronically or it'll really mess things up. And in fact, it can mess up smooth muscle tone and some of these things. And you have children that should have outgrown it that are still wetting their bed. Restless sleep. Do you have a child that wakes up in the morning and their head's at the foot of the bed and their covers are all on the floor?
Mm-hmm.
Well, sometimes it's because they're wrestling around. They just can't, you know, get comfortable and they're not getting enough oxygen and they're moving around, just trying to get settled in, and they never can.
Yeah.
So that would be another thing. So that's little children. Now, with the second category, the young, fit females, I would say a lot of the classic signs that we think of for temporomandibular disorders would be possibilities for airway problems. So you look at the same things we look at the children. So an airway problem is an airway problem, whether you're 2 or you're 20 or you're, you know, 70, there's many of the same things. Do you have trouble breathing through your nose? Do you get, do you have sinus problems? Do you breathe through your mouth? Do you have trouble sleeping at night? Do you sleep soundly or do you wake up a lot at night? Do you have fatigue overall, which could be just because of terrible sleep and poor oxygen levels during your sleep and stress hormone release all night long that just causes you to feel like you haven't been to sleep at all? Do you snore? Now, very important, Kirk, get your pen out for this one. Okay.
Okay. Because right, women never say they snore.
Exactly.
They
You don't ask them that question. That's the wrong question.
Okay.
You say, I know you don't snore, but do you purr in your sleep?
Really?
So, see, okay. Purring is okay. Snoring sounds like a lumberjack, right? Lumberjacks snore, but women, they might purr, so that's okay. And we always get a good laugh when we have that discussion, you know, with a woman asking, I know you don't snore, but do you purr at all during your sleep? And then, well, maybe a little purring, but no snoring, okay.
Yeah.
But no, that's true. And I just last week had a new patient come in. She's in her 20s, and I asked her that question. She says, I'll be honest with you. She says, when I go to sleep at night, before I get all the way to sleep, I wake myself up snoring.
Wow.
She said, so I know I do. She said, I'm single, but I know I do because I literally wake myself up doing. Mm. And so that's an arousal. You know, we call it a micro arousal. That's an arousal. In her case, it literally woke her up. But many people, they won't be aware of waking up, but they go back up to that lightest stage of sleep, and then they settle back down, and it happens again, and then they pop back up, mm-hmm. and they're cycling through light levels of sleep and not getting down where they need to be. Right. And so they feel lousy. So they wake up, and they say, I feel tired all the time. I wake up with headaches in the morning. One of the possibilities, we'll say, for bruxism, for grinding your teeth, would be trying to get your airway open. So I'm grinding forward because that opens the back of my throat. I'm doing CPR on myself to jutting my jaw forward. And then my teeth happen to be in the way. What's more important, anterior guidance or oxygen?
Oxygen.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And so we see people come in, they've destroyed their front teeth, and we're like, why in the world would they do that? And we've never had an answer.
They've been gasping for air.
Yeah. Now, that can go along with clenching too, because you can clench and raise your Adam's apple, your hyoid bone, and it'll slightly open your airway. And so some people, rather than bruxing, they just clench, even during the daytime, during the daytime. And that'll raise the hyoid bone up, and it'll slightly open the airway, and they may be able to get more air through. So clenching, which can create, obviously, sore muscles and headaches, joint overloading and discomfort, can be related to airway. I'm not saying 100% of the time, but we should always be asking that question. Could there be an airway problem? Why is this happening when you're sleeping? That's when you're supposed to be the most rested, the lowest state of physiologic activity, the lowest heart rate. Right. See, everything should be at a minimum when you're sleeping. You don't wake up in the morning and say, I've got a headache and my muscles are killing me. You know, I mean, that doesn't make any sense, right? Unless there's something driving that. I'll tell you a really interesting example. I had a lady come in to see me. Now, this lady was about 40-ish. Okay. And I actually have it on video. And she comes in and she marks down everything's healthy. And she's a respiratory therapist. So that means she works around sleep apnea clinic and lab. And she knows all about sleep apnea, right? That's part of her field in respiratory therapy and breathing and airway and all that stuff. So she comes in and she marks down everything's negative on her health history. But I ask about your overall health assessment, would you call your overall health excellent, good, fair, or poor? Mm-hmm. And she puts down good. Mm. And I said, well, wait a second. You said you have no problems, but you put down good. Why did you say good and not excellent?
Yeah, I'm curious. She
said, well, the reason is because I've had a problem recently that really concerns me, and I hope I'm okay. And I said, well, what's that problem? Here's what she said. She said, I wake up several times in the middle of the night and my heart is racing and my chest is pounding.
Oh my goodness.
And she said, I went to the cardiologist that I work next to and he did an EKG and it was normal. And then he did a stress test and it was normal. And he said, well, maybe it's just that you have a lot of stress in your life. And I looked at her and I said, that doesn't make sense. And she said, yeah. Think that makes sense either. And I said, you're asleep. You know, you're supposed to be at your lowest state of physiologic activity. You should wake up feeling great.
Right.
And your heart racing is a sign that there's some alarms going off that are saying we need more oxygen.
Yeah.
And the most likely cause of that, and I'm not a physician, you know, I'm a dentist, but in my mind, the most logical explanation for that would be if you weren't getting enough air.
Right.
Your oxygen levels are dropping and you're getting these arousals, you know? And I said, have you ever had a sleep study? Here's what she said.
What?
No, I wouldn't be a candidate for that.
Right.
I said, why not? And she said, because I'm not overweight and I'm not a man. And I mean, this is what she thought. And she worked in that profession.
Wow.
And I said, would you be willing to go ahead and get a sleep study anyway?
Okay.
And she said, sure, you know, I can easily do that. I go in the lab, you know, any night I want to. I said, well, let's do that. 2 weeks later, she comes back to my office and shows up. I'm working. And she asked if she could see me. Well, you know, sometimes that's a good sign. Sometimes that's a bad sign.
Yeah.
Oh. So I said, absolutely. So I had her take it into our consult room. And I broke away. I went in the consult room. She's standing there. I walk in the room and she immediately starts crying. Well, that could be a bad sign, right? But it wasn't. And I said, are you okay? And she said, yes. She said, I had to come down and just thank you because I think you saved my life.
Wow.
I said, what? She said, I had the sleep study and it came back that I have severe sleep apnea. And she said, I've been wearing a CPAP for 2 weeks and I've slept all the way through the night with no disruption at all, no distress, no heart racing, chest pounding. She said, that's what it was all along. And yeah. She said, I would have never guessed. And her, now listen, Kurt, her cardiologist wouldn't have guessed either.
Yeah.
And she's working in that profession in a specialty arena. And so she said, if you want me to be on TV, you want me to give my testimony, you want me to talk about this, whatever, whatever, you know, I'm happy to do it anytime. This is, everybody needs to know about this. So
yeah.
I said, well, I'll tell you what, I got my phone right here. Would you mind if I record you? And so I recorded her, and I have it. I use it in our seminars. And she went on for about a minute about her symptoms and, you know, all this and how we found what she calls that loose tissue in the back of her throat and how she thinks it saved her life. And then the second minute of her little testimonial is her explaining sleep apnea to everybody and how serious it is and how you need to get checked for it and how it can cause heart problems and strokes and you can even die. You can die in your sleep, she said. Mm-hmm. It's that important. And so she's teaching everybody about it, but she really didn't understand that it isn't just fat old men. It's right. anybody. It's you and me and her and children and anyone who isn't able to pass oxygen, you know, through their airway into their lungs and through their bloodstream into their cells. And so it was such a wonderful story because it was just classic of just missing it, you know. Mm. I'll tell you another one. And I say this because we are really in a renaissance time and it's time for revolution. You called it, what I call it is I say in dentistry, we're the gatekeepers of complete health, not just dentistry. But there's so many things, whether it's airway and sleep apnea or gastric reflux and the signs we see of teeth being destroyed by the acids, and it's very serious and very, very big deal. But I just lost what I was going to say before. But at any rate, it's a huge thing, and it's not difficult to find. So I see us as gatekeepers for both systemic inflammation and for total health.
Amen.
And we have a tremendous opportunity. Oh, I know what I was going to say. This is something that is easy to understand. I mean, the explanation, you're not a dentist, but you right. know as much as most dentists. But let's say you're just a patient of mine, and I told you about the air conditioning filter and the nose. And if you don't use the filter, what happens to your home and what happens to your body? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Is that easy to understand?
Everybody gets it.
It's simple to understand. It's really easy. And so I'm on the phone about 3 weeks ago now with a friend of mine who I don't know professionally, but I knew he was a physician. All right. And so we're on the phone. He's in the southeast of the United States. We're on the phone long distance. He doesn't live here. And in our conversation about something else, I said, what else is new with you? And he said, well, I'm getting ready to retire. Mm-hmm. I said, oh, that's great. You're a physician, right? And he says, uh-huh. And I said, and aren't you a pediatric surgeon? And he says, yes, I'm a pediatric ENT. And I said, oh, and what does your practice look like? He said, well, primarily I remove tonsils and adenoids and I do ear tubes wow. on children. And he said, and I teach at one of the medical schools, which I won't name because I don't want anybody to know who this is. Mm-hmm. He says, I teach at one of the medical schools in the Southeast United States. I teach residents pediatric ENT surgery. I said, oh my gosh, that's fantastic. And he has a regional referral-based practice in one of the southern cities where people come from around the South to get their tonsils and adenoids removed by him.
Right.
So 70 years old now, been doing this for 45 years. So I asked him, I said, hey, let me ask you, how much are you all addressing or talking about this issue of breathing and airway, like the difference between nasal and mouth breathing and, you know, and what that can do for inflammation and tonsils and things like that. He said, we've never discussed that before.
Wow.
I said, well, I'm talking about, you know, nitric oxide and filtering the air and the antimicrobial effect of nitric oxide and humidifying and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, all that. Right. And the fact that breathing through your mouth can inflame your tonsils because you're breathing dirty air right into your lymphoid tissues and all that. And he said, I've never heard that discussed at any meeting I've gone to. I would be interested in talking with you more about that.
Oh, I'm sure he's seen it for years and years and years. And so
what they do is they go in and they remove the pathology, but they're not answering the question, how did it get there?
The cause
and effect. And in fact, the truth is, if you study the literature on removing tonsils and adenoids, about 50% of the time, they can come back.
Right.
It literally, you don't remove every cell. And so it can regrow if there's provocation. And so we're onto something really big. This is a revolution, but we have the opportunity to influence not only our patients and the health of our patients, but the whole medical community and the quality of healthcare. And also, it's essential for us as restorative dentists. So I don't want to get away from dentistry. This isn't about dentists becoming physicians. That's not my purpose. My thought is we want to be great at what we do and be very thorough and understand cause and effect relationships. So if I see a young person or adult come in and they've got a narrow arch and they're breathing through their mouth and they've got a malocclusion, one of the questions I want to ask is, could there be an airway problem?
Right.
And what would be driving that? Do they have airway obstruction? Is it because they can't breathe through their nose? Do they have deviated septum? Do they have nasal polyps? Do they have allergies to food or environment? See, those are things where I may need to get help from an allergist. I may need help from an ENT to evaluate it.
Right.
Those are things that we would see as part of the sequence of our analysis for then working with their occlusion. But the other part of this, Kirk, that I think most of us, including myself for sure, have missed through the years is this, is that even those of us that consider ourselves very comprehensive would say, okay, if you're really good, and you're in the top 10%, you're going to actually take impressions of the teeth and take a bite record with the joint seated and a face bow, and you're going to mount it on a semi-adjustable articulator, and you're going to analyze the occlusion. And the point of occlusion is we're looking at the fixed upper against the movable lower, right? So we think of this part as fixed and this part moves. And the whole subject of occlusion is how do we get the lower to fit into the upper?
Right.
What we don't usually ask is the upper okay?
Right.
Because if the upper is all compressed, which also means the airway is compressed and the tongue is laying low in the mouth and there's breathing problems and, that's a problem in itself physiologically and health-wise.
Right.
We often don't address the upper. We just try to make the lower fit it. When actually, in many cases now, the future discussion that's already here, that you're hearing many talk about, restorative dentists, orthodontists, I could name people all around the United States from California to Virginia to, Michigan and Florida and everywhere else in other countries. They're talking about expanding the dental arches to expand the airway to improve the breathing, to stabilize the occlusion and to improve the ability to breathe nasally. So all of it goes together. You see, it's not one or the other. It's not dentistry and medicine. But the fact is we're getting in on it so early that even the physicians, for the most part, don't know about it.
Right.
And so we have a tremendous opportunity to create a network, in our community by those that are open, educating and sharing information that we're learning with those and creating wonderful, synergy among those that really are committed to solving problems. Now, the old fat guys, Keith Thornton, we had an interesting conversation last week, and he was telling me, he said, yeah, so many of the guys that you and I see that are the 60-year-old guys that, have malocclusions and they have airway problems and they've got severe sleep apnea and they're either using a CPAP or they can use an oral appliance. He said, I call them roadkill.
Oh, my.
Because we're getting there so late and so much damage has been done. I saw a guy just last week, actually on Tuesday as a new patient. He came in and it was the most tragic story. It just broke my heart. I really literally had tears. He came in and he was a television executive in Los Angeles.
Okay.
He's probably late 50s now. He had to retire 2 or 3 years ago because he was diagnosed with esophageal cancer.
Oh, my.
And he was told by the physicians there that it all started with gastric reflux. So now I'm able to go back with him in time and say, okay, let's talk about that. Because we understand now that sleep apnea, one of the reasons for gastric reflux is sleep apnea. So if you're trying to breathe and your airway's blocked and you have a negative pressure, then it creates a diaphragmatic effort, you know, to get air in. And it can actually create a backflow, if you will, and a pressure whereby the stomach acids start to come up the esophagus.
Yeah.
And so there's a strong correlation, maybe up to 70 to 75% of the time people with sleep apnea will have gastric reflux.
Wow.
Now, what happens, of course, is you've got this acidic, caustic environment up and down your airway from your throat all the way down to your stomach, and it irritates the lining of your esophagus, and there's more to this story, but what can happen then is you develop what's called Barrett's esophagus, which is basically an irritation and inflammation of the esophagus, and that can potentially lead to esophageal cancer. We now know that the number one fastest growing cancer in the United States is esophageal cancer. Wow. And there's a growing incidence of sleep apnea. The other thing it can relate to, there's a physician in New York City named Jamie Kaufman. And Jamie Kaufman's probably the top gastroenterologist in the world on the subject of reflux. And she calls it airway reflux, and says that when you have those acids coming up in pepsin, which is the digestive molecule for protein, can adhere to the walls of your esophagus and your airway and start eating away at the lining.
Right.
So that's another part of it. And she blames it on our acidic diet because she says the pepsin, which digests protein, is stimulated by stomach acid. And so when you're drinking soft drinks and acidic drinks and foods, and canned foods usually have a pH of 4 or below because they use acidic preservatives in canned foods. But all the acidity in our Western diet can stimulate irritation coming from that pepsin irritating the walls of your airway and can lead to these things. So acidic diet plus sleep apnea can lead to this. So this fella comes in and talks with me. He's had his whole esophagus removed from his throat down to his stomach. Everything was removed. And then what they do is they stretch your stomach up to your throat and connect it there. So his stomach is now like this. He has chronic digestive issues. He's very sick. He's taking narcotics every day for pain relief. Now, you know, it makes you want to cry. But when you listen to his story, I said, let's go back. I mean, this is all new to us. So let's go back 30 years and pretend like it was today.
Right.
30 years ago, what signs and symptoms did you have? He said, I've always had heartburn since I was he said, for over 30 plus years, I've struggled with heartburn. And so that's a sign of gastric reflux. Okay. So then he said, snored like a freight train his whole adult life, tired during the daytime, all the signs and symptoms that we now know can be related to sleep apnea and gastric reflux.
Right.
So
right.
If he walked into my office today at 30, he would have never gotten esophageal cancer. I guarantee it.
Wow, this is awesome.
Isn't that powerful?
It's powerful.
But what makes me so sad is we didn't meet him 30 years ago and know
right.
this. But, I mean, he wouldn't have to be really, literally handicapped now and barely right. alive. It was a miracle that he survived it.
Yeah, and this is the opportunity you're talking about. This is the Great Awakening. This isn't a small deal. Like, this is a huge epidemic. And if you're watching this, you know, first of all, Whit, I am so grateful that you would share this message because it's huge. It really is one of the most important elements of what our profession is a part of for the future. And it's a tremendous, you know, just watching this or listening to you, my first thought is, oh my goodness, like all the pieces are starting, like there are pieces that are starting to fit. why this is the way it is. And now, so here's what I want to do. If you're watching this and this has intrigued you even a little bit, a couple things. Number one, if you haven't been to the Dawson Academy, you got to go.
Yeah, you have to go.
There's no question about it. It's fantastic. The first step in going to the Dawson Academy is Seminar 1. Right. Now, you guys have Seminar 1 coming up in March. It's in March 31st.
Right.
And you're actually doing it in Chicago. Is that correct?
Or yeah, that'll be with John Cranham. So
awesome.
It's not me, but John Cranham. And that's March 31st in Denver and then June 9th in Chicago.
June 9th in Chicago. And then you're also doing, of course, so write that down, March 31st and June 9th in Chicago. You got to go. It's a fantastic experience.
Two-day course, by the way, Friday and Saturday.
Two-day course.
It's a 2.5.
Or 2.5
days. Now it's two days. Yeah, Friday and Saturday.
Mm-hmm. So there'll be a link right here on the side. If it's it's right here. Just check it out and go. And then secondly, you're doing a course on this very subject where we'll get to see all of it. It's on April 28th and 29th in St. Pete. Can you tell us about that?
In beautiful St. Pete.
Beautiful St. Pete. Sorry, I left that out.
It really is a beautiful city. What we're going to do is we're going to take this subject that we've just touched on, integrative dental medicine. And what I do is I break it up into four B's, I call it the four B's. Bite, which has to do with the whole TMJ occlusion aspect that is what our focus has been through the years. Bacteria, so we want to talk about oral pathogens and its effect on the bloodstream and cardiovascular effects, et cetera, and the digestive tract. And then we're going to talk about breathing. So what we were just talking about now with airway problems and the implications of breathing and airway diagnosis and treatment of that. And then the fourth one is body. So we'll get into some systemic effects like nutrition, which we just touched on. We'll go into greater detail. And in fact, David Seaman, who is my hero on the subject of nutrition and systemic inflammation, will be teaching that class with me.
That's awesome.
So he'll be lecturing in that class. And he has a book called The Deflame Diet that people can buy that just came out this year. But that'll be April 28th and 9th. And we, I think, still have a little bit of space for people to join us. But I would love for people to join us and get to know them personally and talk about this one-on-one.
Yeah, check it out. So if you're even thinking about going, don't. Just go.
Just go.
Just go. You'll love it. You'll absolutely love it.
We'll treat you well.
And I can say firsthand, these guys are first class. Just great, great human beings and extraordinary education and incredible experience. So Whit, thank you so much for being on. I really appreciate this, buddy. I have so many more topics I want to cover with you and the rest of the faculty at the Dawson Academy. So I'm very grateful for this opportunity, buddy.
Thank you, Kurt. It's always a pleasure to talk with you and learn from you too.
Well, thanks, buddy. And so if you're watching this, feel free to add any questions even after the show has aired live. Please add the questions and I'll ask Whit to respond to them. And I know you'll have some great ones. And so thank you so much. And if you're watching this, thank you so much for watching. If you're enjoying these, please hit the share button, spread the word. We'd love it. And please let us know if there's any topics you'd love to see here in the future. I've got so many friends in dentistry and we haven't even scratched the surface of what's going to happen here in the future. So until we see you next time, thanks for watching. Whit, stay on for a second, okay?
All right, Kurt.
All right.